Hey, welcome everybody to my first spoken video blog. Now, I've uploaded videos before, but usually I use subtitles for highlighting. But this video is going to be a little bit more involved, so I thought, well, maybe it's better just to talk you through it. As some already know, I'm trying to build my own multicopter flight controller. And yes, that's me testing some new altitude control algorithms. And as you can see, it's working pretty well. I'm working on this project for 8 months now, and the results are quite nice. Here the quad flies fully autonomous, with telemetry information displayed on the ground station. And maybe nice to know is that the soft and hardware are built from scratch. I did not use AeroQuad or MultiWii software. Now here you see the hardware setup so far and the Arduino that runs the main program. And in this video block I want to talk about the hardware. Well, actually the sensors, to be more precise. This is an example of a gyro sensor I used in my project. It's a gyro sensor mounted on a larger so-called breakout board. Perfect for prototyping, but the size of these boards are massive. Now, these boards come in various quality, price and sizes. Some manufacturers even claim that they use the best quality sensors on the market. Well, quality is in this case what the user expects. And what can you expect for only a few bucks? And last but not least, you probably don't want your compass on the same location as the rest of your sensors. In other words, you probably want to make your own sensor board for prototyping. Now let's have a look at the Farnell side. There is a massive amount of sensors available on the market that we can use. Now this is the place where you can find the latest and probably the best sensors available. Now if you don't know what sensor suits your application, you could simply use the filter. Just check the boxes of your choice and apply the filter. Now as you can see, most of these sensors have land grid soldering masks, and they are not suitable for hand soldering. Now please don't forget to compare the specs and check the data sheets. There is a ton of information in these data sheets that you need to know. And usually, in every... There is an example schematic that you can use. And after you order them, you can compare them with the size of your other breakout boards. Now here you see a gyro and an accelerometer compared to the breakout boards, and whoop! And as you can see, these things are tiny. I just love them. And it was this picture that made me wonder if it would be possible to solder the tiny sensor dead box style and connect it with little bond wires to the circuit board. Now if you turn the chip upside down, it looks like a dead bug. And that is where the term comes from. Now, sometimes it is used for fast prototyping, or in this case, making your own sensor boards. By using the CAD program Eagle and the schematic in the data sheet, I made a circuit board layout. Now, after completion, I sent the layout to an etching company that made the actual board. And as you could see, the size is only 12 by 30 millimeters. Here are the etched boards. I ordered several in case I mess up during soldering, and I really love the quality of the etching. It's very neatly done. So now that we have our boards, it's soldering time. First, I apply a little bit of super glue just to hold the sensor in place during soldering. While doing this, make sure that the sensors are correctly lined up to each other. For soldering, I use this stereo microscope with 10 times magnification and a 0.2 mm soldering tip. I found this to be the best setup for myself. First, I apply a little amount of flux on the contacts to make sure that we have a nice and clean connection. Flux really increases the quality of the soldering joint as it removes possible contamination. And after that, I apply solder to the pads. For the bound wires, I use a single copper wire out of this multicore cable. These cables are used for modern railroads and stuff like that, and it's easy to obtain. And again, apply a little bit of flux to create a clean solder joint. Now it's time to solder the bond wires on. This takes a steady hand and patience to get it perfect, so don't rush yourself while doing this. And remember, the pads are only 0.2 by 0.2 millimeters. After completing the soldering of the bond wires, it is time to cut them to the correct length. And when everything is in place and there are no shorts, the wires are soldered to the pads on the circuit board. To get the gyro to work correctly and reduce electrical noise, it is necessary to solder some capacitors and resistors. I chose the component size 0603 for this board. These components are 0.6 by 0.3 millimeters. You can keep one hand free during soldering if you apply a little solder on one of the pads. Now it's possible to keep the component in place with a pair of tweezers while it is soldered into place. It is not advisable to pre-solder both pads before placing the component. And of course, apply a little amount of flux before soldering these components. And with everything in place, the board is finished. Although the sensors are mounted depth box style, it is possible to get a nice and tiny board. Now I just need to add some wires for testing. And there you go! Your own 6 degree of freedom board with I2C interface, ready for testing! These sensors are running at 3.3 volts and it is necessary to have a level converter. Although there are 10K pull-up resistors on the level converter, I use two additional resistors. The 3.3 volt is supplied by the Arduino Uno. On the breadboard is an Atmega 328 and a 60 MHz crystal. This processor will run the test program. Now this is the same processor as on the Arduino Uno. This is a serial converter, so I can receive data on my computer. I use the Arduino Uno as an ISP programmer. And that is why there are extra wires going to the breadboard. For testing the board, I wrote a small program to check the output of the gyro. Now in this section, I2C and serial ports are initialized. Now at startup, the gyro is disabled by default, and this command enables the gyro. On this last section, reads the data from the gyro and sends it to the serial output. Now let's see if we have the correct serial port for uploading. Yes, that is correct. And upload the program by using the Arduino Uno as an ISP programmer. And there we go. And here you can see the LEDs blinking during upload. And when the upload is ready, it is time to check the serial data. I'm opening a new Arduino environment and selecting the correct serial port. And now let's see if everything works. And yes, it is working! Ha! We have data! Oh, beautiful! Now let's move the sensor a bit and see if these values change. And yes, they do! Oh! You can see it's working like a charm. Now I noticed something strange while probing the I2C clock pulse. Now as you can see, the clock is only running at 333 kHz and not the selected 400 kHz. Well, all the advised 10K pull-up resistors are in place, so what is going on here? That's strange. But after a while, I figured out that by adding two extra pull-up resistors, it is possible to increase the slope of the clock and the data signals. And there we have the 400 kHz clock pulse. Well, maybe it's the breadboard that is messing things up. I mean, I don't know. But if you're only running 10K resistors in your application, it might be a good thing to check. I mean, you lose approximately 20% of your I2C speed due to this. Now everything is working perfectly, it is time to secure the bond wires. I choose 5-minute epoxy for this after testing that it is not conductive. When adding epoxy, please leave an opening at the top, so the sensor can breathe. Now, these sensors contain some small amounts of moisture in their housing, and it is very important that the moisture can expand due to temperature changes. And there is the final result, my own 6 degree of freedom sensor board with my own choice of sensors. Exactly the way I want it to be. Ha! Beautiful! Hey, thanks for watching!